Divine Truth Events. These are events and presentations by Jesus and Mary. This presentation is part of the Relationship with God series. The topic is Understanding Your Emotional Self, presented by Jesus and Mary Magdalene on the 8th of February 2014 in Kentucky, New South Wales, Australia. This is Session 1, Part 1.
Don't know how today's going to go because Mary and I are getting hammered by spirits today. So that's usually an indication that they don't want you to hear what we've got to say. And that's been pretty much the tone of our entire visit this last week and a half, actually. We've been pretty much hammered the whole time because pretty much every spirit around you doesn't want to hear any of this material and doesn't want you to hear it either. So, yeah. Should we bite off the individual issues first, do you think, or get straight on to the material?
Who'd like personal feedback straight away? Perhaps we can just talk about the particular issues that we were going to talk about, so it might clear the air somewhat.
Yeah, guys, all feeling pretty heavy today.
Yeah.
Honestly. And.
A lot of you are in addictions with each other straight away, and with us, as soon as you come in.
Mm.
Yeah.
And that's an indication that you want those addictions, isn't it? And that's an indication you don't want to give them up. And we really are not going to get very far today if you don't want to give up some addictions, to be honest. So what we feel we need to do is talk to you about some pretty basic stuff about relationship with God. That's probably something that we see the majority of people on the planet still don't understand with regard to their relationship with God. But before we do that, there needs to be some kind of desire inside of yourselves to receive the information. Does that make sense? And this is the problem with us having a bigger group like this. Like, our original intention was only to have 5 or 10 people here who we felt had a desire for their relationship with God. And then as different people heard about it, then you've talked to other people about it, and eventually the larger group comes. But to be honest with you, many of you are not desiring a relationship with God very strongly. And so the material is going to be challenging anyway. And sometimes you're more worried about missing out on something than you are about applying what you already know. The other thing we'd like to raise with some of you have the attitude that whenever Mary and I do anything, that it's your right to be here. And we don't feel that way, actually, that it's your right to be here. We feel, actually, that what we would like to do is share with people who really want to grow our time. And quite often we feel from people who feel that it's their right to be here that they don't have a desire to grow. They just have a desire to have certain addictions met by being here. And that's not what we want to do anymore. What we want to do is share with people who really have a desire to grow, towards God in particular. So what we'd ask you to do is firstly to analyse whether you have a desire to grow, really, a strong desire to grow towards God, and a strong desire to love. Like, the feeling we get from many of you that you say you do, but as soon as you're put in a situation that's a bit tricky or difficult, you revert to old unloving behaviour immediately, and that's an indication that no real soul change has occurred. And so the question then becomes, well, why has no real soul change occurred? And what we would like to discuss with you today is a basic principle that we feel is the main reason why no real soul change has occurred for most people who hear divine truth. Does that make sense? So the subject of today's discussion is relationship with God. So it's part of the Relationship with God series. And we're calling it Understanding Your Emotional Self. Understanding Your Emotional Self. Now, the reason why we've decided to have this chat with you today is because we feel the majority of people still don't understand one of the basic principles of the way to God. And that basic principle is this: without you becoming a fully fledged, 100% emotional being, you will never have a relationship with God. Does everyone get that? Without you becoming a fully fledged, 100% emotional being, there is no way that you'll ever become at one with God. And what we would like to talk to you about is how you do that, like, and the contrast between that and what many of you are currently doing. Does that make sense? And how much many of you invest in your emotions rather than actually allow your emotions. And we'll talk about what we mean by investing in them in comparison to allowing them. We'll talk about how many of you want to talk about emotion rather than feeling emotion. Does that make sense? And no real change can occur without you understanding that your soul is going to be 100% emotional. Like, you're going to be emotional all the time. So once you're one with God, you will be emotional all the time. So the first thing we would like to say to you is this: the way you see things at the moment, the way you hear things, the way you interpret things, the way you taste things, and the way you touch things, and the way you believe things to be, with your intellect, the way you analyse things, the way you feel things at the moment, the way you see the universe around you, the way you see God and yourself and others around you, all of it is out of harmony with how God sees you. And do you know how we know that? Because if it was in harmony with how God sees you, you would already be at one with God. So what I'm basically saying to you is even the very way in which you think is completely out of harmony with the way God originally designed you to think. The way that you currently feel is out of harmony with the way God designed you to feel. The key is to not get all like complicated about that, but to realise the truth of that, that the way God designed you to be is not the way you currently are. The way you currently are has been completely controlled and manipulated by the environment in which you have lived. And that environment has been completely the opposite way of dealing with anything than the way God originally designed you to deal with everything. Completely the opposite. Now, I feel most of us have no concept of that at this stage. We believe the life we currently have is reality, and it's not. From God's perspective, it's not. And we are so addicted to this reality that we think that we understand what's being said to us when we talk, when we have a discussion about divine truth, and we don't. What we have instead is even our thought and intellectual processes have been distorted by the environment in which we live so much that it's impossible for us to really understand what's going on, what's being said to us even. We interpret every statement of what's said to us through the filters that have all been distorted. It's like having a great big filter, like a water filter, and having it coloured with mud and then pushing some water through it and hoping that you're going to get some purity out the other end. And it's not possible. It's just not possible. So the question then becomes, like, how do we get from that place where we're almost every single part of our life has been distorted in some way, where even the very way in which we think, the way in which we feel, the way we see the world, how we see things, how we even taste things and feel things and hear things is all distorted by these filters that have been placed within us at a very, very young age, usually soon after conception. How do we get from that place to being at one with God is the question. And the answers are really simple, but the majority of us don't engage them. Right? And we would like to talk to you today in particular about emotion and its impact on your relationship with God. the type of being we need to become if we're ever going to have a relationship with God. Now, I think of God like God is the grand emotional being, if you like. If you want a definition of what it means to be an emotional being, God is it. Every single feeling God has is instantly transmitted to every single fear, to every single creation of God that God has a feeling for. And it's a constant flow of feelings that God has from God to all of God's creation. Now, the only one of God's creation that doesn't feel that flow is the human soul creation. And the only reason why we don't feel that flow is because God designed us with this beautiful trait that only the human soul has, and that is the trait of being able to determine for yourself what you desire to feel. Does that make sense? In other words, free will. That's what free will is. The ability to determine what you are going to feel. That's free will. Now, many of you probably haven't thought of free will that way. You thought of it like the ability to do whatever you want or whatever you desire. But it's also the ability to determine everything you feel for yourself. Does that make sense to you? You can ask questions at any time. Do you get that? Laura, you want to, if we just have the mic?
Sorry, I was just, the ability for us to feel.
To determine. What you want to feel. That is free will. And when I say feel, emotionally experience, the ability for you to determine what you're going to emotionally experience is a part of free will, the gift of free will that God gave you. The main reason why many of us are not connecting with God is because we are determining what we want to feel that's out of harmony with what God would prefer for us to feel in order to have a connection with God. So it's actually our desire to use our, or to actually, in most cases, suppress our emotions that causes us to not have a connection with God. And then we throw up our hands and say, oh, a connection with God's too hard. But a connection with God isn't hard. What's hard is doing what you're currently doing, suppressing your emotions almost 100% of the time. That's hard. It requires a lot of effort. You get a lot of spirit influence in that place. It just is really, really difficult in that place if you choose to suppress your emotions. But that is an expression of your free will. And God gave you that gift. So all of God's creations, all of God's other creations are feeling all of God's emotions all the time. Right? Now, of course, creations here on earth have a difficulty, and that is they also feel all of humanity's emotions all the time. So all the animals and the birds and the other living creatures and even right down to the viruses and everything all feel our emotions as well as God's. And this is where a distortion occurs. This is where problems get injected into the environment, if you like, through our emotional condition. And very few of us at this point really understand how much our emotions affect absolutely everything around us, everything. And, you know, without your emotions, you can't have a relationship with God. You can't have a relationship with yourself. You can't have a relationship with any other person. You can't understand or have a relationship with anything in the universe that God has created, because all of the things God has created in the universe are dependent upon you feeling something emotionally. You can't understand feelings. You can't understand the primary feeling that you're going to need to understand to grow, and that is love. And so your definitions are going to be completely flawed, right across the board, right? It means that everything you look at, even the way you see it, is completely distorted, right? So, for example, somebody gives you a gift, like us giving the gift of sharing our time with you, and you come to expect it. You no longer see it as a gift, you see it as something you can demand. That is a distortion of the truth about that. We have these distortions that occur all the time, right? And we are constantly engaged in these distortions with the way we perceive everything. Most of us, our perception has been totally controlled and manipulated by the filters that we have. And if you could think of your brain like a great big processor, do you know what I mean? Like a processor of information. Now, I often think of the brain like a computer CPU, central processing unit, you know? And it just sits there, there's our central processing unit. And what does the central processing unit of a computer do? It just gets information fed to it, doesn't it? And then, of course, it makes decisions based on the information fed to it. Now, with us, most of the information that gets fed to our intellectual mind at this point in time is totally manipulated and filtered through our emotional condition. So even our thoughts that we have are completely incorrect in most cases from a point of view of harmony with love. The things we think are loving are not. We've got bad data in, and you're only going to get bad data out and bad decision-making out of that. That's how it is. And that's the way we need to see it. Does that make sense? Now, instead of feeling all heavy about that, there is a very simple way that God made to make all this go away. And very few of us are engaging it because we are still thinking that we're already engaging it when we're not. Does that make sense to you? For example, many of us believe we have progressed when we have not. Many of us believe we understand divine truth when we do not. Right? Because the only way that you can progress and the only way you can understand divine truth is by feeling some emotion. And in fact, becoming a 100% feeling emotional being is the only way that you're going to understand God's truth. That's why there's a limitation in the sixth sphere of people with regard to their progression intellectually, because they can't understand anything that God has made. They can't even live in God's kingdom, if you like, the area above the eighth sphere or dimension, unless they make this transition into becoming a 100% emotional being. And most people who are listening to divine truth do not even understand that right now, even if they've been listening for 6 years or 7 years or 8 years. They don't understand that. They don't understand how important it is to become a 100% emotional being, to become 100% in that place where you're always feeling, never thinking, always feeling. When I say never thinking, thoughts will come from the feelings, not the other way around. At the moment, what we have is an intellectual dominant life, and the majority of us still have that. We're completely dominant intellectually. Now, we've talked in the past a lot about intellectual dominance, but many of you have not considered that your very way of existence with this intellectual dominance is completely out of harmony with the way God designed you to be. And many of you get complicated about that too. It's not even your fault that it's like that. Because by the time, for most of you, you were 3, 4, or 5 years of age, you were taught to think this way, look at life this way, see things this way, hear things this way, everything based through the emotional filters, right? But the key is, how do we undo it? That's the key. Now, is there any questions you'd like to ask up until that point about the condition we're in? Can we go?
Philippa, yep.
Philippa? Just the mic across. Thanks.
I don't really understand what you're saying about the thoughts will come from the feelings.
Mm. It's like perhaps we need to draw a little diagram or something just to help you with that. I've drawn this before many times, Philippa. So, you know, here's your soul. Right, and then here's your spirit body, right? And here's your physical body. The physical body has a brain, which basically physiologically controls the body itself, right? And controls a lot of the essential processes in the body. The spirit body has a mind, right? Where most of your life experience in your first incarnation in particular is stored. So if you're in your first incarnation, the mind stores pretty much most of your experience. as does your soul. Now, remember there's a cord between each one of these things that feeds information from this part to that part, yes? And feeds information through the cord into the next part. Now, most of us, and most of us were taught this before we even were taught how to think. You were taught how to think by the way in which your parents think. And you were taught how to feel by the way in which your parents feel, right? And that being the case, that means that your mind has become the dominant thing in your life. Your parents taught you that your mind should be the dominant thing in your life. But what I'm saying to you is that's not true. What is really true is the so-called subconscious, which is, doesn't exist at all, but which is actually your soul, which stores all of your emotional experience, is dictating every thought that you have in your mind right now. So if I scratch my nose and someone taught you that scratching someone's nose means they're lying to you, you will have that thought based on the emotional experience, when the reality is my nose might be just itchy. And that might be the only complication about the reason why I'm scratching it. Does that make sense? We interpret so many things based on what we've been taught intellectually and also primarily what's gone on in our soul. So it's what's in our soul. What's in our soul might be don't trust anybody. So we may have a feeling of mistrust. And then we got taught intellectually by somebody that when a person scratches their nose, it means you can't trust them. And of course, that enters you without any logic because they could be just scratching their nose because it's itchy. But you think, no, it means you can't trust them because you've already got emotion inside of you that's open to the thought that anything might be a sign that you can't trust somebody. And so you then automatically become open to that new belief. So your soul, your emotions actually, are determining what you even think right now. Everything you do is determined by your soul's feelings, of which most of us are not conscious. And that's why nowadays a lot of times there's this reference to the subconscious. And what I'm saying is, no, don't think there's a subconscious. There is just conscious and not conscious. All right? And not conscious is you're denying the emotions you feel, but these emotions are still having an input into your day-to-day life. So if you think of it, your brain like a microprocessor, a CPU, and you've got data in, the data coming in is flawed. So every thought, even the way you think, is flawed. So of course the decisions you make, the things you do, if you could say the choices you make or the decisions you make through your processing intellectually, are going to be flawed. And yet you don't believe they're flawed. You think they're right. But from God's perspective, they're already flawed because the data coming in is flawed and the data coming in comes from the soul and the soul's emotions have been flawed through a process that everyone on the planet basically has gone through, and that is from the moment you incarnated, you've had imposed upon you the flawed emotions of your parents and therefore the flawed experiences. Now, their interpretation of those things in the mind is going to be the natural result of whatever flawed reasoning you have in your soul. So what's going on in your mind, even right now, is completely dependent on what's already been input into your soul up until this point. Does that make sense? And if you can see it that way, you can start to see that if you're going to change, what are you going to have to do? The real thing that most of us are trying to do is we are trying to change our mind. That's what most of us are trying to do. We're trying to go, oh, I've got to do the loving thing here. What's the loving thing? Oh, I don't really know, but I think it's this one. You know, there's our mind. See, our soul, once we've released all its negative emotions, knows instantly what the loving thing to do is. You won't have to think about it, sit down and worry about it for days on end. You'll just do it, right? Because that's the power of your soul. Your soul has the power to express itself emotionally all the time. Does that make sense? All the time. That's where true progression comes from, our soul, not from the mind. But most of us, all we've done when we've heard divine truth is swapped another way of thought for divine truth thinking. And from God's perspective, there is no such thing as divine truth thinking. There is only divine truth feeling. But we've just swapped one method of thinking for another way of thinking. In other words, we're listening to divine truth terminology, but it's just really a thought. It's just really another faith of some kind that is intellectually based. It's not even true faith, because all true faith is based on the soul. So what we've done is we've gone along with this and we've said, right, okay, I've heard all this stuff, sounds good to me. And to be honest with you, if you think back over the 5 or 6 years that you might have heard it, for many of you, it hasn't always sounded good to you, right, either, if we're honest. But we go, it sounds good to me, I'll try and do that. But all we're doing is using our mind to attempt something that only, from the way God designed it, can only occur in our soul, in our emotional state. And this is why many of us are not successful. Right? We're not successful because the actual soul transformation doesn't occur. It's just a changing of our minds that has occurred. Right? Does that make sense? So the biggest problem that we face really is this constant idea that has been drummed into us by our environment that the mind is supreme. You even have religious practices today that are all based around the mind being supreme. And you even, like, every time we talk about emotions with members of the media, they get freaked out. Like, honestly, people are so afraid of emotions that they don't even want the media to talk about emotions. They worry that somehow you can be emotionally manipulated. The only time you can be manipulated is when your emotions are out of harmony with what's in your mind. That's the only time you can be manipulated. Right? Now, unfortunately for the majority of us, that's all the time. So we can be manipulated all the time because our emotions are completely out of harmony with what's in our mind. We think one way while at the same time feeling almost completely the opposite emotion. Does that make sense? Now, I first feel that what we need to do is understand the importance of emotions. Like, and what is going to happen to you in your future if you engage the divine truth in the way that God intended you to, which is the way. So if we can call it the way rather than divine truth, the way is basically the soul engaging emotionally. Right? With one addition, engaging emotionally with God. Right. Now, most people have huge difficulties even engaging emotionally, let alone engaging emotionally with God, someone who they don't half the time believe exists or that they've got a huge amount of emotions about that are negative. Right? But the way is basically emotionally engaging this loving process with God, not intellectually engaging it. In fact, intellectually engaging it is going to be pretty much impossible. God's designed it to be impossible because your very soul is not intellectual in its nature. And that's why it's impossible. God wants to connect with your soul, not with your mind. God wants to connect with your feelings, your real feelings. So this is where we got to start asking ourselves, what are our real feelings? What are our real feelings? And we need to be honest about our real feelings if we're ever going to make any progress in the way to God. And most of us are not honest about our real feelings. You know, honesty may happen occasionally in the course of a day. But the rest of the time, we're in total denial of our real feelings most of the time. And that's a problem, right? Yeah, that we need to sort out somehow. Now, the first way you sort it out is by changing your belief systems, right? Now, belief systems can't really change without the soul being engaged. That's the sort of the problem. It's like a catch-22. How do I change belief systems that my soul's not engaged to change? And that is our primary problem. But is there any questions so far about that? About if it is.
I've definitely been one of those people who've used my intellect to control my emotions, and what I see for myself and a lot of people attempting the way is we think we're feeling.
Correct.
And I cry and I think that I'm doing something, and I had an experience only a few days ago with a psychologist who does a particular type of emotional psychology, mm-hmm. and she kept saying to me, and I said, but wasn't that sadness? She goes, no, that's anxiety, because you don't want to feel what's underneath that.
Yeah.
And it was a revelation, and it got down to the point I had to admit and feel that I had murderous rage towards my mother.
Yeah.
And that I actually went through a process of what I would really want to do to her.
If you could.
If I could get away with it. Mm. And that, even that process, her standing in front of me afterwards, I couldn't look her in the eye. Mm. She said that you've had that rage since you were a tiny child, and you've judged yourself, that you've wanted to murder your mother.
Well, your mother judges that emotion too, of course.
Yeah.
So that's where your judgment came from.
Okay. Mm. So are you saying that she potentially could have had that rage towards her mother as well?
No, I'm saying that she did things to you that created the feeling of rage within you that you couldn't express.
Right.
Does that make
okay.
sense? And that she didn't want you to express. And the problem is not that you had the feeling. The problem is that you weren't allowed to express it, right? The problem with not expressing a feeling is that it gets locked up within you and guides the rest of your life. That's how the unhealed emotions in your soul govern what you think. Does that make sense? And then to go one step even further, you've preferred to not even think that you've got that emotion.
Absolutely.
For most of your life,
yeah.
because that's what your mum wants you to think. Mm. Does that make sense?
Yes. Yeah.
So even the desire to avoid the very thought is driven by her desire emotionally.
And so with that, linking that with spirit, so ever since then I've been not sleeping and feeling really quite attacked.
Yeah.
Is that because I'm going through a process of initially stepping out
Correct.
Against that belief?
Yes,
and it will feel really uncomfortable
yes.
when you're confronting those beliefs.
It will, but even the thought that it's uncomfortable is actually something that's out of harmony with the way God designed you to think. The reality is emotions, from God's perspective, are not uncomfortable.
Okay.
They are just feelings. God doesn't see any of them as uncomfortable. Do you understand?
I think I do. It's different. Like, I've never felt rage in my body before.
Correct.
It was a different experience.
And you're afraid of experiencing it. And that's what creates the feeling that it's an uncomfortable emotion. Does
right,
that make sense?
Okay.
And the fear itself was being created because every time you've experienced such rage in your childhood, you were suppressed in some way, or love was withdrawn in some way, and so you weren't allowed to feel it. Does that make sense? So even the very way you process anger is distorted by a whole heap of belief systems that your environment imposed upon you. And because of that, we invest in the emotion. Do you understand what I mean by that? Like, what we do is we go, oh, this emotion is terrible, it's so big, it's so terrible, it's so shocking, it's like a monster and it's really, really bad, and you want to talk about it with everybody and share it with everybody and how bad it is. Isn't it terrible that we've got to go through these things? And that's what I call an investment in an emotion. When we allow emotions, we don't invest in emotion.
So we're not going to be sharing all that with other people and wanting to draw them into that.
Correct. You'll want to just feel it and get it out of you. That's all you want to do.
And still talk to God through that process.
Of course. You'll need God's help through that process sometimes, but the reality is you can do that even without God's help. You can process emotionally that deep without God's help. It's a bit more painful, of course, but you can do it. But the reality is that's the way God designed us to be anyway. Whether we eventually want God or not, at some point in our future, we're going to have to connect to these emotions, to connect to the reality of what we really feel. Now, of course, there are many... Your mother doesn't want you to do that in her current state, right? She's never wanted you to do that from the time you were little, which is the reason why the entire emotion is locked up in the first place. And the spirits around you are the same kind of people like your mother. So, of course, they don't want you to do it either. And then, of course, you're afraid of doing it, which means that all they've got to do is put a bit of pressure on you to stop doing it. And you go, okay, I'll stop doing it. It's all too uncomfortable anyway. And that's why we get the spirit pressure to change our behaviour back to the original status quo. In other words, the spirits around us want us to meet their addictions the way we currently do. They want us to live our life the way we currently do. They don't want us to change, because if we change, then they won't have their addictions met through us. And so, of course, they're going to try to impose some of their rage upon us, which means we get quite frightened when we're actually making some change.
So that I'd need to look at my addictions with that, wouldn't I? Because correct. I'm just becoming aware how much I don't want to feel.
Yes.
My whole life.
Yeah.
Like, it's just...
And to be frank, most people don't want to feel. In fact, if you had a percentage of an entire population, you could almost say 100% bar a few people don't want to feel. That makes sense. That is the normal state of humanity at this point in time.
And can I go back to what you said in the beginning of your story, Vanessa, where you said that the lady who was with you pointed out to you that the feeling that you were feeling wasn't sadness, it was fear. And I see a lot of people, because they don't want to get real about what their emotions are, because they have these beliefs and investments, just really taking the approach of going, crying equals grief, shaking equals fear, yelling equals anger. And that's not my experience of processing. You know, I can cry in rage, fear and grief. And it's possible to cry in self-punishment and distraction and having a tantrum and wanting to just feel like poor me. And none of those latter things are even helping
feeling.
My soul.
No, not even
they're not
feeling.
They're not connecting with the truth of what is emotionally inside of me. And recently I've had discussions with people who are saying, well, I feel like I'm angry, but and I went and bashed a pillow, but then I started crying, and that's just me skipping to the grief, isn't it?
No,
I wasn't crying from grief. I just wanted her to stop pushing me to feel.
Correct.
I was just like, go, just leave me alone. I this is too uncomfortable. You're pressing too
exactly.
many buttons.
Correct.
But the point I'm trying to make is that it requires a level of honesty from within us to identify that, to say, when I'm crying all of a sudden, I don't even want to feel what that's about if I'm saying, oh, I'm just in grief. You know, when we really want to connect to our soul and feel our feelings, it's not a mystery what we're feeling. You know, not like, oh, tears means grief. We're saying, wow.
We know what we're feeling about.
Actually, I'm crying because I'm terrified. Like, and it was wonderful that someone could help you make that little light bulb moment of going, just because I'm crying, it doesn't mean whatever. She could say, it's fear that I'm feeling from you. And that helps you go, yeah. I can get more real about what's going on for me emotionally. And I see a lot of people avoiding that whole... because they're afraid of feeling and because they have these false belief systems about what it means to feel. Identifying with the emotion... investing in the emotion. Or a common issue I've had is identifying with it and saying, well, if I'm angry, that means I'm bad and nasty and forever.
So you mean judging, which...
Correct.
I don't know if you...
I make it a part of my identity. Yeah. I say, yeah, that means if I have anger, I am this person.
I am the mud.
Yes.
Correct.
Exactly.
Rather than the mud just being something you can wash off.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah. And emotion is the way in which you wash your mud off, not by thinking. Yeah. You don't do it by thinking. You do it by feeling. And emotion is also the way you accept new truth. So you don't do that by thinking either. You do that by feeling. So, in fact, the way God designed your soul is that pretty much every single physiological, spiritual, emotional and sexual thing that goes on inside of your soul is completely based around feelings and emotions. Everything. So God designed you in such a way that when you begin to use your intellect in a dominant manner, that actually all of your processing of different feelings is going to be flawed. It's a purposeful design. And we go, isn't this terrible that we've got to feel an emotion? And God's going, no, it's not terrible. It's really good that you've got to feel an emotion. And you say, no, it's not. It's really bad. I don't want to feel this emotion. God's saying, you need to feel this emotion. Get it out of you, you know. Let it go. Let it pass through you. Let yourself experience it. In the moment, you'll feel like the person who's in a rage. You'll feel like your rage. But if you fully experience it, it'll pass through you. And after the experience is finished, you won't feel the rage anymore. But we don't believe that. We believe the emotion is going to make us a permanent rageful being or a permanent murderous or a permanent whatever, you know, permanent shameful person or a permanent tear crier all the time, you know, the things that we hate from our emotional experience in our childhood. We're worried that our emotions are going to make us that permanently. It's impossible. You will become a 100% emotional being where you let every emotion flow as it occurs. And when you do that, there is no possibility of any emotion being stored in you.
It's not a question if I can continue.
Yep.
So an example in my life, I've had a lot of resistance to crying even because my grandmother was, my maternal grandmother, overly emotional and she used to cry, oh, do you love me? I just need my family to love me.
But that's a drama queen. That's not crying.
Yeah, so but what I'm just learning is that is the addiction. That's
correct.
That's me not having the tantrum. I want this from you and I'm not getting it. So I've been judging crying and emotions for so long because mm-hmm. I didn't want to be that person.
Yeah. Yeah, God doesn't want you to be a drama queen. God just wants you to have all the emotions that are there flow through as they are. Now, when your mum's going, oh, do you love me? You don't love me. You know, you're crying or your grandma. She's not expressing her true feelings, which are she feels no one loves her and she wants you to love her, so it's just a demand coming out of her, and she's learnt to be emotionally manipulative by crying it, and that means that everyone goes, oh, isn't it terrible? Yes, we love you, you know, and she gets some of that emotion satisfied, but it's all fake. Like at the end of the day, she's not feeling the emotion that's going to cure her, which is feeling that nobody cares about her, which comes from her childhood, of course. So this is our problem, is that we can go through emotions, but it doesn't mean we're making any changes at all. We've got to be real about what they are. Does that make sense? We've got to actually feel the actual one, mm-hmm. the real emotions, not the ones that are the facade. The facade is just a figment of our and our environment's creation. And this is what we do. We often live in it for the rest of our existence. Even right to the time we hit the spirit world, we're still living in it. And then you get the spirit world and you look at your body and go, gee whiz, that's looking pretty bad. Maybe there's something wrong with me. Now, you know, now that you can see it, you start feeling there might be. But before then, even though we're getting old and decrepit and our hair's falling out and we're getting wrinkled up and we're getting diseases and sicknesses and, you know, we still don't think it's something that we've done. We don't see it as something that's out of harmony with love that exists within us. We see it as something external, as always, because that's what our environment taught us to see. You know, you think of the average person on the planet, when there's a grasshopper plague, what do they blame? They don't see it as their soul created it. They don't see it as their choices with regard to the food habits and their choices with regard to how they, you know, develop food production is all contributing to that plague. They don't see any of those things. They just go, it's a terrible plague, isn't it terrible? Yeah, you know, it's one of these acts of God that we blame, you know, and as if it's an act of God. No, God doesn't create such acts.
Thank you.
Yeah. We need to start seeing things very differently if we're going to progress. That's the reality. Okay. So,
about this now. I like this bit.
Yeah. I was thinking, though, that I just want to make the comment that if we can just remember this one statement, that the way we do everything currently is completely in disharmony to the way God designed us to be. This is why we have so much pain. It's why we have so much suffering. Because the way that we live and the way even that we think is completely out of harmony with the way God designed us to be. And we need to bear that in mind. So every time you want to think you've progressed and you haven't progressed, that's just a thought, you know. It doesn't mean anything. The thoughts can also come and go, but unfortunately, for most of us, we don't get rid of the reasons why they come and go, which are all to do with the emotions we're still holding on to. And I can't sort of highlight enough how essential it is that we understand, that we get this very basic understanding about emotion, that without it, progression is impossible. And it's not a process you're going to go through. And we'll talk about this now, like how we currently see our emotions. What we want to do is compare how we currently see our emotions with how God sees emotion. Does that make sense? And once you see the comparison, you'll start understanding where you have engaged the world's viewpoint of emotion and where that needs to change. Yeah? Laura?
I've recently, like when I start watching movies now, like just even a comedy, like a light comedy, the way that the women treat the men, I don't want to watch the film. If it's too violent, I feel the violence in my heart. David Attenborough documentaries, Killer Whales Chasing Seal, it's everything's too violent.
Yeah.
And I just feel that if I was an emotional being and, like, I normally walk away, I'll switch the film off and say, Fab, I can't watch this film.
Yeah.
But if you feel like if I sat and I was emotionally open to just how violent everyone is to each other in nature, that I wouldn't be able to, that's my fear of how would I
live
and engage and watch a movie. Like, my entertainment's gone. I don't like going to the movies. My music, I can't listen to music. Like, the woman singing sounds like she's angry. Like, everything's getting distorted.
Yeah. Well, can I point out, though, that the way you're seeing this is still like you're investing in your emotion. You're basically thinking that if you feel about how the violence of the world, that in the end you'll believe the whole world's violent, and that you'll just be living in an entire... You're already living in it anyway. Like, the reality is the world's not... Violence is not going to change just because you see it. You either not see it, and you do choose at this point in time to not see things so that you don't feel. So if you chose differently, if you chose to feel what you see, you have a chance to heal inside of yourself.
So that would be the experiment of going, all right, Laura, this is now all coming at me. It's just been the past maybe 2 weeks that it's amped up.
Yeah.
Of just going, all right, it is bad. And if every movie, every music, every word that's
the world's
spoken,
a lot worse than you think it is currently, yes.
Yeah, and these aren't bad movies. I'm not watching bad horror. Like, I'm just watching normal TV or not a normal documentary or something.
Yeah, it's like, you know, horror movie right there on my TV. And it turns out being, what, the 6 o'clock news.
So they're all the little judgments that you're just talking about that make us enter the thought of why we can't feel, because then we're going to be emotionally unsociable or...
Yeah, see, all you're doing is you're, again, making some flawed intellectual choices. See, you believe that feeling the emotion that the world's violent is going to somehow mean that you're just going to be stressed out about living in a violent world for the rest of your life, right? And that's not true. But that's what you believe. That's what you've been even taught to believe. So your way of addressing emotion is basically ignore it.
Yeah, walk away. Disappear.
Yeah, ignore it, make it go away, get out of it somehow, right? That is, again, the flawed way in which your mother in particular deals with emotion, and your dad too, if you think about it, you know, he does
dad
the same, right?
Yeah.
He walks away even more than your mum does. She'll have a good fight first. And this is an indication that you've just taken on even a flawed way of handling your emotion. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And so this is the key thing with regard to our emotion. Having a bit of trouble with that camera. It's going on and off. Do you need an SD card?
We'll see how it goes.
Yeah. But all you're basically doing is saying, right, if I avoid the situation, it goes away. And it doesn't. In fact, any situation you generally avoid gets worse.
That's actually a beautiful opportunity. I just don't even have to get out of my own house. I just open the TV. It's music, and it's an opportunity to feel how violent we all are to each other.
Yeah, yeah. And once we feel through that, the feelings in our childhood of violence that occurred to us will release, and then you'll see some beauty in the world after that. And if you don't see it in the world, you'll at least have it in you. So therefore, the rest of the world will see it.
And that faith can only come through going through the process.
Correct. And most of us feel like we don't want to go through the process, so we don't. And so we never make any changes. And then we, 5 years down the track after hearing Divine Truth, we look back at it all and we go, oh, yeah, I don't know how we're doing, really. I don't think we're doing any good, or... I know I haven't changed much, but I don't know what I can do about that. And then after a while, after you start feeling that, you feel like, oh, it's all pointless anyway. And this is why a lot of people finish up leaving what they thought initially was the truth, and they leave it because they haven't done any emotional change. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Do you want to sort out the camera? Just have a break to sort out the camera.
Because it's so hot.
No, it's not heat. It's... What's the battery like?
It's all full.
It's all full? Do you want to...
I can... If I just have it on standby, I can still record it.
On the Ninja, but not on the camera.
We can do that.
All right. Yep. Okay. Okay. Okay, so how are we going so far?
It's rocking my world a little bit.
Rocking your world a little bit. Yeah. Yeah, well, you know, it's, we need to start seeing the importance of the emotion, becoming an emotional person. Like most of us, we don't see it like that, and this is what we'd like to talk about with you now, how we actually see it now. How we view emotions now. And I think when we discuss this section with you, you'll connect with this is how most of you feel about emotion. Do you know what I mean? And even these feelings that we're going to discuss with you about emotion are an indication of how much our whole concept of emotion has been distorted and how much it's interfering with our progress towards God. Yeah. Okay, so let's divide this section into two areas, shall we? So what I might do is just rub that off the board. So let's divide it. So this is about how we see emotion. And the first section we'd like to talk about is the way in which we see it
why we feel we should even feel.
Yeah, like if we just have this as a bit of a preamble first, if you consider that all the stuff I've taught you about divine truth, I've taught you a lot about emotion, about these, the necessity of getting into it and the necessity of processing and so forth, right? Now, in the process of that, the majority of you now have a belief about emotion which is false. And that is, you see emotion as the process and you see being without emotion as the end goal. Do you understand that? So first thing I'd like to raise with you is seeing emotion as a process. When we see emotion as a process, we're seeing it as something we've got to do in order to get somewhere else. So if I can liken it to travelling to a city, like here in New South Wales, capital city is Sydney. If I'm travelling here from near Armidale to Sydney, I've got to follow a process to get there, don't I? I've got to, you know, usually it will be a vehicle that I get in of some kind, so I've got to go get in the vehicle, I've got to have fuel in the vehicle, I've got to have some money to buy the fuel. So all of these things are all part of the process of me getting this car ready. And once the car's ready to travel the, what is it, 900 Ks, I don't know what it is from here, something like that, 800 Ks or whatever, 500 is it, Ks from here to Sydney, then I'll get there in the end, as long as I follow that process. And that's how you see emotion at the moment, the same way. You see emotion as the process to a destination, a process you've got to follow to get to the destination. And what I'm saying to you is emotion is the destination. Does that make sense? Like, so instead of seeing emotion as a process, what we need to see emotion as is the destination, is where we're going to be in the end. But we don't see it that way. We see emotion as a process to reach a destination that we have no idea what it is really at this point, because we're just guessing, right? Because you've never been there before. It's like you've never been to Sydney before, so you don't know what it really is like. You might have seen a few pictures or whatever. And you followed a process to get there, getting in the car, paying for fuel, all that kind of stuff, driving there 500-600 Ks or whatever it is to Sydney, and all those kind of things you've done, that's following the process and you got to your destination. And I'm saying, no, emotion is your destination. So what's the process you've got to get to get to that? That's called the way.
And this is where I feel like we're very... Sorry, Lynn, stand up. Is that better? I see a lot of us thinking, right, I've got the, we've all accustomed now to this teaching, right, there was stuff suppressed in my childhood, I've just got to get that out of me and then I'll be good, I'll be fine. And the truth is, really, what we want to teach everyone is that that happened, absolutely, but the way to get it out of you is to change your state back into the way that God created you to be. So in your childhood, your natural state was suppressed and your natural state is emotional. And so embracing the way means embracing your natural state again. And in that process, all of the backlog of unfelt emotions will come out of you. But also, all of your emotions about right now will happen, and all of your future passions and dreams, and that will all be emotional. And you'll live the rest of your life in this very emotional, beautiful state. So I see a lot of people saying, right, I've just got to get rid of the backlog and then it'll be, you know, just like zen, all zen. Everything's going to be just groovy. But the truth is, all of, and this is where I feel, and I might be jumping ahead, the law of attraction really comes into its own. The reason God created the law of attraction is so that if we are able to respond emotionally to what comes towards us, naturally the emotions of the past will be released. But the way I see everyone engaging where they see emotions as a process and they're still very mind dominant is analysing what comes towards them through the law of attraction, trying to, based on the belief systems that are acceptable to them from their childhood experience and the emotions they think they're allowed to have, based on the beliefs from their childhood experience, they go, okay, that happened, that was with a guy, it was probably about my dad, what am I comfortable thinking about my dad or feeling about my dad? Yep, I think that was an attraction event based on that. And you can see how you haven't even engaged emotionally with the attraction. And this is why Jesus is always so passionately, beautifully saying, if that happens, go and feel about it. If that happens, go and punch a bag until you feel something else. Don't sit and try to analyse
it all.
Yeah. Yeah.
Can you see what we're saying about the destination versus the process? Yeah. And if you examine how you've considered emotion at this point, for the majority of you, you can see that you've viewed it as a process to reach another destination. You don't see it as a way to become a completely 100% emotional being. Because you sort of don't see that that is what it means to be at one with yourself, to actually be a 100% emotional being. You will become at one with yourself. Not at one with God. To become an emotional being at one with God, you need to have all of God's emotions within you about a subject. And that is obviously an additional process to this. But both are necessary with regard to your progress. You follow? Yeah, Laura?
So can I just clarify? So I think that's what the mind wants to do. You got to feel your anger, feel the addictions, feel the, and then you get to the causal grief, and then you'll be more loving, and and it's like this. The process is to get to the end destination.
Yeah. So the question then becomes: why did I explain that process to you?
Because it is the truth, and it is a process that we'll have to go through.
Correct. but have I ever said to you, you should go through that with your mind?
No.
No. What I've said each time is a feeling is above a feeling is above a feeling. Isn't that what I said?
Yes.
So once you learn how to feel any feeling, can you see you have no problem with the process?
I guess what I'm asking is the end destination isn't to be, even more loving or on with God, but it's to be an emotional being where you're just fit. Is that what you're saying?
No, for me, the end destination is to be an emotional being that is completely at one with God. So I'd add the additional, that is completely at one with God. That's my destination. It doesn't have to be yours.
So when you say...
You've got free will, right?
The destination is to be an emotional being. You're not saying that there's always going to be emotions. You're just going to say...
No, there is always going to be emotions, yeah. Always. If you're at one with God, there is not a single moment in your day where you don't feel something. Does that make sense?
But they're just good emotions.
Well, of course, you're at one with God. But if you have not learnt how to feel, you wouldn't be believing they're all good emotions. To be honest with you, for many of you right now, if we got you and we shoved you in the celestial kingdom, you'd be bawling your eyes out most of the time and feeling it's very traumatic to live there.
Which is why God creates a place where you feel more comfortable.
The lowest fears are where you're going to feel more comfortable. Does that make sense? Because you're used to suppressing emotion. No one in the celestial spheres wants to suppress a single emotion. You imagine living, like, you ask Mary what it's like living with me and I still suppress emotion. You imagine what it's like living with a person 100% of the day where they don't suppress any emotion. None of you really even have a concept of what that's like to even live with such a person. But that's why most of you would be in intense pain living in the celestial spirit world at this point. Because the emotion coming from everywhere around you tells you to feel everything and you don't want to feel everything.
And that's why the law of attraction is giving us the opportunities now that are within a loving... It's loving for us to be experiencing what we're experiencing because this is what we're ready... This is
what we've chosen. See, you keep using the term ready, Laura. It's not ready, it's chosen. Okay. See, ready is a way of thinking that says, something external to myself makes me ready. In other words, it's a way of blaming something else on your own use of your will, right? The reality is you chose to deny. That's a choice. It's an exercise of your will. It's very, very different once you start understanding this. That every time you use the word ready, you're basically saying that you're not responsible for making a different choice. You will become ready through some external event occurring which will actually cause you to be ready. No. You are ready right now as long as you make the choice. Does that make sense? Most of us don't make the choice. And that's why we think we're not ready. And most of us are going, I don't want. And then we say, I'm not ready to cry about that yet. No, you don't want to cry about that yet. See, it is a choice. You don't want to cry about it. It's like with the earlier example you gave, like with your mother, you don't want to feel the rage with your mother. It's a choice made. It's not that you're not ready to feel it. It's been there ever since you've been a child, 1 year, 2 years old, 3 years old, getting suppressed all the time. There's been so much built-up rage in you, you'd love to get rid of it, right? At some level, the child would have loved to get rid of it. But now you're making a different choice. You've got to see it as a choice.
And it's a symptom of fear to want to deny our choices, to say that we don't have a choice. Fear likes us to say, oh, no, it's too hard. You can't.
I'm not ready.
You're not ready. But really, that's just a product of fear.
It's
and
that classic
you
saying,
face they, some fear.
They say God gives you what you're ready for, you know. That.
Yeah.
You only get what you're ready for.
Yeah, well, that's a lot of crap. It's a lot of New Age mumbo-jumbo, to be honest. It is. You get what you desire. You get what your will expresses.
Every one of God's laws interacts with your will. So, yeah.
Yeah.
God wants us to understand the gift of free will in every way. And so when our will alters even slightly, God's got a law ready to interact with us in a new way. So that's why the law of attraction brings us new types of events suddenly, because God can feel, oh, there's something changed in the will. And so I've created a law that's going to help you with that right now.
Custom made, yeah. Everything's custom made with God, right?
Awesome design.
Mm. So first thing we wanted to raise, babe, what?
No, I just thought maybe we could
talk
about...
Want to flesh this out a bit more.
Yeah, some of the symptoms of things that happen when we view emotion as a process.
So what are some of the symptoms, do you think, of seeing emotion as a process?
Chore.
It's a chore rather than a...
Desire.
Desire.
A duty rather than a desire as well. Hey?
It's a duty. Mm. Or a longing, yeah. What else? Teresa?
It's temporary.
See an emotion as a process.
Like you only have to do it for a little while. And then
yes, so you feel it's temporary. Rather than a permanent condition. Yep. Very true. Anything else you can think of?
What about if you use the analogy of driving to Sydney again, if you've never been there, and you've never even driven a car, say, and someone says, right, now you've got to get in the car and drive to Sydney, what might you want someone to give you?
Directions and help.
Just wait for the microphone.
Wait for the mic, yeah. It's good, Louise, isn't it? Yeah. We need it recorded.
Yeah. Good directions and, like, help and tell me about it. Tell me everything they know about it first so that I can be prepared.
And give me an instruction manual and break it down bit by bit.
And where will I go through? What are the towns I'm looking for?
Yes.
Yeah, did I get it right? Have I taken the wrong way?
Exactly. Yeah.
Which way is the best way to go? Which way do you think? Should I go every way?
Do you notice all the questions you ask me? Aren't they pretty much all of those kind of questions?
Yes, all the time.
Yeah.
And I'm not finding out for myself.
Yeah. How do you find out for yourself?
Well, I've got to feel it.
No.
I've got to go there.
You've got to go there. That's how you do it.
Be present while you go
through the experience. So what would we call that versus what? What is it here if we're comparing? So one's a list of instructions or something or concepts or ideas, right?
Yep. And one's okay. And one's that my personal experience, like my...
Rather than experience.
Yeah. Yep.
This is why hardly any of you know how to apply love in any situation. Do you know that? We see you constantly being unloving, even after you've heard, and sometimes directly after you've heard in a session like this, what love is all about, you go and be unloving straight afterwards, while we're still here. Right? That very frequently occurs, right? And that's because... all I'm doing is presenting concepts to you. That's all I can do. I can't make you have the experience because the experience is your personal experience. You've got to go through the experience. When you go through the experience, it will no longer be just a bunch of concepts that you sometimes know how to use and sometimes don't and sometimes get mixed up. It'll be a very firm experience that you know when you're being unloving and you know what it feels like and you know when you're in addiction and you know what that feels like and you know when you're trying to hurt somebody else and you know what that feels like. It won't be just something you guess about anymore. Yeah?
this is why it's so important that when, like, I have a tendency to do something unloving, go into fear and try and fix it.
Yes.
You know, and take this big action.
Yeah.
Whereas, yeah, I've answered my own question. If I just actually just felt how horrible that felt, I probably would be least likely to do it again because...
Correct.
I know it feels terrible. Correct.
And also you'd naturally be drawn to correct it in a way that's loving rather than based on fear of making a mistake or wanting to appear good to others still. And if you really let yourself feel after you've done something and go, oh, that felt bad, I don't think that was loving on my behalf, and let yourself really go into that emotionally, you naturally then start to see, oh, I know the best way to correct this.
Yeah.
Because you see more truth about yourself and the situation.
Because often you just create another terrible situation.
Of course, because
you haven't felt anything.
Because the very way you think is already flawed and the very way, you know, all the emotion is still there that governed the way you think. And of course you're going to take an action based on the way you think that is all flawed and it's all going to create another flawed response. And another
and
one,
does,
and another one, and another
does.
One. And lo and behold, it does. And then after 20 of them, we go, this isn't working.
Yeah.
AJ's doing something wrong with teaching us what we're teaching. You know, that's what we do. We even blame the source of the information rather than going, actually, obviously, I don't feel love yet.
Yeah.
Otherwise, if I felt love, I'd know what to do here.
We had, AJ and I had a beautiful conversation a couple of months ago. I don't know if I told you or Louisa about it, but... we were discussing fear and I was quite in a stuck place and I just adore my man's honesty because he said to me, look, what are you afraid of? Losing your friends, being ridiculed, like being out of control, not having a relationship with me. Honey, you've lost them all already. It's already happened. You know, stop living in fear about what's going to happen because it's already happened.
And Mary was saying to me, look, I don't know if I want to feel that because if I feel that, you might not like me anymore and you might leave. I said, we don't have a relationship anyway, right as it is. I'm not getting the real you, so we don't have one anyway. We've already lost the relationship. So why are you worried about losing something you've already lost?
It's not even there in the first place.
It's not even there in the first place.
And sometimes I feel that about a lot of people get anxious and come and ask me, what's the loving thing to do in this situation? How can I be loving in this situation? And lately I feel like saying... it's already happened. You're not loving. Now we've got to work from this point and start feeling so that we can really know what love is. Yeah. Instead, it's a product of fear that tells us I've got to, you know, and it's I've got to safeguard against possible unloving or unhappy things happening. And yet we're not often facing the truth that it's already like that and we can connect to that and move on from there. But that's the only way we're going to move on from there.
Yep.
Like, if we look at things realistically, many of us are afraid of losing our families, right? But the majority of us lost our families when we're three. Like, we've not had a sincere interaction with our families since then, many of us. Like, so we've already lost them. Like, how can you think you're losing something that you've already lost? Like, there's obviously even a thinking, some kind of malfunction in the CPU. There! Does that make sense to think that? And for many of us, that if we look at most of our life, that's what it's like. Many of us are worried about losing the relationship we're currently in. Isn't that not true? You're worried about who your soulmate is, might not be the person you're with, whatever. The reality is most of you don't have a relationship with the person you're with. You have a bartering system with the person you're with. And to be frank, you need to lose that. Mm-hmm. If you're ever going to be happy, that's what's it's going to have to go, right? So, you know, we often fool ourselves into thinking we have something. And sometimes we even go to ourselves things like this, which is a very sad way of thinking, I feel. Something's better than nothing. And I can't agree with that. Mm. If that something is very bad, it's angry, you know, sad and all these other things, it's not better than nothing. You're better off having nothing than that, you know. But God's offered you this concept that you're actually able to have happiness, which is more than that as well. And we often just justify something as better than nothing as a justification is not a very clever or logical justification as a reason for choosing to not feel an emotion.
Yeah. It's like you can't hold two things at once in the same hand. If you've got a bad situation and you're holding on hoping, or if I do this other thing, then I'll get approval, without feeling it and being willing to let it go, you don't make any space for the good thing to come.
And you know that from a theoretical idea, but most of us aren't doing that in practice. We just hold on, you know, like, and it just gets worse. And then eventually we go, I can't hold on anymore. Should have just given it up holding on 20 years ago, you know, and you would not have lost 20 years holding on. And this is what we also do, is we put off things. We hope, in this place, we hope rather than feeling reality. Do you know what I mean by that? Like, we live in our hope rather than just accepting reality.
Yeah.
These are all the results of seeing emotion as a process, right? If we go page behind.
I think I've just experienced this morning.
Have you? How?
In that I've realised that, well, to a degree both of us have, but that I've been hoping that I'm not a gay soul.
Right.
I've been hanging on to this thread that maybe it's not true.
Right.
Maybe it's not true.
Yeah.
And that if I don't let myself accept that, then I don't have to feel everything else that's out there coming at me.
Yeah.
Because I am a gay soul.
Yeah.
And I realised that means, because I'm hanging on to that hope, none of my relationships are real.
Yeah.
Not with myself.
Yeah.
Not with Kerry.
Yeah.
Not with God. Yeah. Not with any other person that I ever meet.
Now, can I even make it worse for you? Can I even make it worse for you?
Yep.
You might go through this feeling and realise you're not a gay soul.
That too.
That's how amazing our emotions are. When we let ourselves feel them, we can go through feelings that we 100% feel at the time, but because we're passed through the emotion, in the end we come to the truth. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And we need to allow this process to occur, right? So yes, it's a sad thing that you've been hoping that you're not something. That's a terrible thing, no matter what it is. If I'm hoping I'm heterosexual when I'm not, or I'm hoping that I'm gay when I'm not, either way, it's just holding on to something. When we see emotion as a process, that's what we do. We hold on to concepts, we prevent the emotion from flowing.
Yep, and that's what I realised this morning.
Yeah, yeah. No, it's a good realisation. If we come forward to Teresa. Anything else that you can think of here, just as seeing emotion? What are the results of that, Teresa?
What I see now is that's highlighting a block for me, is all of this, because I have this thing about what if I'm wrong, and hearing that everything is wrong, everything I think is wrong, everything is wrong.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, well, I don't want to see how wrong I've been.
Yeah.
And so it's a massive. Yeah, because if I was wrong, I was punished. I had to be right.
Yeah, and God doesn't punish you for being wrong. That's the other thing, of course. But we don't even realise that until we go through that feeling.
Yeah, Eloise and I had a good discussion the other day where she was saying, I'm so afraid that what I'm feeling might be Spirit's feelings and I've got to feel my feelings. And she was really, really panicking. And I said to her, just feel now. And if it's Spirit's feelings, then that's the only way you're going to know. You're going to discover the truth by just letting yourself feel. Mm. And then you'll have learned something about what it feels like to feel Spirit's emotions versus your own. But there's a huge fear, isn't there, on the planet of, oh, what if I get it wrong? What's going to happen to me? Mm. And actually, it's a whole, God designed this awesome experiment, which means that, yep, you're going to get it wrong before you get it right, probably.
And I don't even think it's God's experiment. Like, God doesn't experiment with us.
No, sorry.
We're the ones that experiment with God's reality.
It's an experiment for us, yes.
And the reality is, like, from God's perspective, this is the reality of your future existence. And yes, what you're saying is very true. Most of us are so worried about getting something wrong that we're not prepared to feel anything. Right? We're not prepared to feel anything because we're worried that even the feeling might be wrong.
And that our whole life has been wrong. And what's the point? Because it's just been...
Yeah, well, to be honest with you, yes. For the majority of us, our whole life has been wrong.
Yeah.
And what has been the point? Yes, I agree. There's been no point. Does that make sense? Like,
but avoiding that feeling doesn't help us get to a life that is a point.
Yeah, so
just has a point, right?
Just want to avoid it forever sort of thing, yeah.
Yeah. And the reason why a lot of people suicide in this planet is because they do feel that their life has no point. And to be frank with... most of us on the planet need to feel that, and most of us are suicidal most of the time because we do feel that as a feeling, right? But we do need to feel that feeling, that there is no point. The reality is, from God's perspective, there is a point, but you're not going to feel that until you get rid of this feeling that there's no point. Yeah.
This, you spoke very beautifully about this, I think, in the event that we had in Texas late last year, where you talked about addictions and why a lot of us feel like we don't want to break them is because we actually underneath feel like we're powerless and it's hopeless. And this is very closely related to that feeling that there's just no point.
Mm. Yeah, that was awesome.
So this is a part of us seeing emotion as a process, you know, seeing it as a process rather than the destination. So in other words, if you're focused on emotions being the destination, can you see that it would change your concept of what you do every day? You wouldn't be trying to prevent emotions every day, would you? If you saw emotions as the destination. But seeing emotions as a process means that you're trying to use the process to reach a different destination. Does that make sense? And this is where I feel many of us have made this mistake. Once we start talking about emotion, we start seeing emotion as a process, and then we're not seeing it how God sees it. No, emotion is the way God created you to be. That's the expression of you. That's the expression of your experience. That's you having the experience. Without it, you can't live. Without it, you can't experience anything. Without it, you can't feel. Without it, you're not going to enjoy anything. Without this experience that's emotional. Yeah. We want Pete up the back, and then we'll come down to Catherine.
We also want safety and control in the process rather than, you know, what's going to happen if we actually do move through it. So we're trying to control the whole event. So
yeah, seeing as emotion as a process causes us to try to control the emotion. Does that make sense? You're trying to predict what the emotion will be.
What it's about. And
yeah, so you control rather than allowing. That's what you do. Right. As soon as you see it as a process, you will control it. You will try to manipulate it. You will try to trigger it. You will try to do, you know, you'll do things. Like I get constantly people saying, do you go there to trigger the emotion? I'm going to trigger the emotion. Like some of this terminology bothers me. Like I know we use it, but some of the terminology bothers me because even the terminology is flawed. You know what I mean? Like this whole concept of trigger an emotion? No, you are an emotional being. If you're 100% emotional being, how do you trigger an emotion that's already being experienced? There's no such thing, right? So triggering emotion is only a concept we have because we don't feel emotion. If we felt emotion all the time, we wouldn't be using the word trigger an emotion, because we'd be feeling it anyway. Like, there's no need to trigger anything because you're already feeling it. Does that make sense? Like, even the way we see all the terminology, it bothers me a lot. As I've said to Mary many times, I sit down and say, look, you know, this whole emotional processing word, what's that? I don't get that. Like, it's a term that I use that has now been turned into something different. To me, processing an emotion is feeling an emotion. It's not actually a process. Do you see the difference? And now it's come to mean a process. And I'm going, it's not a process. It's feeling the emotion. It's that's why lately I've been using the term experience the emotion rather than process the emotion. Do you see what I'm saying? It means the same thing, really, at the end of the day. But the problem with using the term process emotion, people then think that it's a process. You know? And that's not what I'm trying to say at all. Like, it's not a process, it's an experience. You know, it's like, and this is the trouble with words, you know. The trouble with words is that describing, this is why I used illustrations a lot in the first century, because the only way I could get to describe something to somebody was to get them to do it in a picture. So, you know, the picture that I just gave you of destination versus getting to the destination, right? That's a picture that you formulated in your mind. And I did that to try to help you understand that the destination is being an emotional being. That's the destination. Being an emotional being who is also in harmony with love, with the way God loves. That's the end destination for me, right? And what I'm trying to say to you guys is, look, see it. See that as the destination. Don't see sort of zenned out, cool, as the destination. And up until then, it's an emotional process. It's the destination is you will be a 100% emotional being. That's the destination. And the real question is, how do you do that? How do you become this 100% emotional being? From being totally numbed out, zoned out, tuned out, you know, rageful, angry, you know, facade-y, to becoming that person. How does that happen? That's the real question, right? But we'll cover some of the points about how we do that. But we first need to understand where we're headed. And I feel for many of us, we haven't understood where we're headed. We've thought that being at one with God is some kind of place that we believe is going to have some magical properties, and one of the magical properties we feel it will have is that we won't have to experience any emotion.
All that traumatic stuff will be over.
That will be over.
Like, won't have to sob anymore.
Like, and you will experience emotion. You'll even cry for joy when you're at one with God. Yeah, you'll do it quite frequently, actually. Right? And you'll be completely comfortable with it. Right? And you won't have to go to your next door neighbour and say, oh, I had this terrible experience, well, I was just crying for joy. You know, like, you won't even have to discuss it with anybody, it will just happen, right? And this is the thing is we need to see that is the destination rather than imagining some other destination, you know? And I see the problem is that many people who have left the path of divine truth haven't seen this, right? Most of them, and the main reason why people leave the path of divine truth is because they become exhausted. And the only reason why you ever become exhausted on this path is because you don't do it. Do you understand? Like, if you truly engage all of your emotions, which was the way God created you to naturally be, you're going to find it easier, not harder. If you're finding it harder, it means you're not doing it. It actually is a relief to do it. Your whole body feels relief. Your soul feels relief. Everything feels relief to do it, to actually connect emotionally. And you don't care whether it's a what we classify as negative emotion or a positive emotion. You just feel the emotion. That's what you do. And when you do that, it all passes through you, and so you're left with a lot of energy. You're left with a lot of joy as a result. That makes sense? If we have no joy, it's because we're getting stuck in the process. Right? We're not seeing the end goal. We're not seeing that actually this is about me learning to be an emotional being. It's about not only learning how to do it, but allowing my capacity to do it to continually expand for the rest of my existence. Mm-hmm. So your capacity to experience emotion right now is very limited, right? But what God's trying to help you do is become a person who 100% of the time experiences emotion. And then once you get to that point, let's call that, and if you've done this with God, you'll be at one with God by that stage. And then that's only the start of the journey. The next part of the journey is learning how to expand the emotional abilities. So the power of the emotion becomes so intense that it affects everything around you, it affects everything inside of you, it determines what happens the rest of your life. And you keep growing and expanding in your capacity to feel. Does that make sense? That's what your soul growth is all about, actually. Growing and expanding in your capacity to feel. If you receive divine love, your soul has the capacity to continue to infinitely grow in how you feel. Does that make sense? If you do not receive divine love, your soul has a limited capacity to feel. But it still is about how you feel. But it won't be as powerful as feeling when you're in this unlimited process. Does that make sense? And that's the primary difference between engaging your soul from a sort of a natural way without God and engaging your soul with God. The primary difference is the ability to grow infinitely, the ability to live immortality, compared to the ability to have a limited growth to the sixth dimension and no immortality. And God's love causes the difference between those two states. But in the end, you're still going to have to grow. You're still going to feel. Vanessa? Oh, sorry, I was going to come down first to Catherine. Sorry, so let's go there.
Just another add-on to that. I feel it's going to be fearful and cause pain.
Okay, fear and pain. How many of you feel that? Fear and pain when it comes to thinking and emotion. Rather than what? Joy and freedom. Like, I look at most people's lives who are feeling emotion as a process and I go, wow, you make it so complicated. Your whole lives are so complicated, honestly. Like, what I would think is a simple thing to make a choice or decision about, many of you worry about it for days or weeks or months or years, and some of you don't even make the decision. I've seen some of you for 5 years waiting to make a decision, still haven't made. Right? Okay. Why are you making your life so complicated? It's just a decision, you know what I mean? It's just an emotion. You have to go through a bit of pain maybe, but that's just a feeling that will pass through you. Many of you feel you invest in it so much that you believe it's how you're going to be the rest of your existence. Yeah. You believe the pain's going to be forever. The fear is going to be forever. All of these things, it's going to be forever. It's not like that at all when you truly engage your emotions. It's much more simple than that. That makes sense? It's much more enjoyable.
You said something great to me the other day. You said, the way God's designed it is that if you feel something that's in error, really feel it and connect to it, it's going to dissipate. If you feel something in harmony with God's truth, it's going to grow. It's going to continue. And that's awesome, isn't it? Like, you know that if you just connect, God's designed it, that it's going to leave you. If it's an error or if it's pain or fear, it's going to leave you. You have to just take that step of connecting to it. Yeah.
So you could say in some ways the biggest problem we face is a lack of faith in this, isn't it? Like, we don't really have faith that that's true. Mm-hmm. And so we want to use our intellect a totally different way, because we believe, and even our lack of faith comes from our distorted data in to the CPU. Can you see that? Like, the reality is, if God is a loving God, created the universe in a loving way, surely we can have some faith that if we experience negative emotion, it will leave us. You know, God wouldn't have created a way which causes us to retain all negative emotions. You know, can you imagine God up there if God retained all negative emotions? You imagine having like 60 billion children, most of whom are unruly.
And blaming you.
And blaming you for being so. That'd be pretty intense to feel, right? Imagine if God stored every one of those feelings. Like, it was really, oh. Then I'd say we'd have a very angry God, right? You know, you look at the average parent with two children doing that, and it's pretty bad. So, yeah, I just feel like we overcomplicate things so much here. We do. By wanting to not see what the end result is, we're not really seeing that the emotion is just an experience that's transient. The only time when you become the emotion you feel is when you hold on to it.
Mm. The opposite of what we tell ourselves. Tell ourselves, if I experience this, this is me. When actually if we experience it and it's an error, it'll leave us.
Mm.
But holding on to it, that's when it governs our life and our nature and our actions.
Yeah. And you don't become joyful by holding on to joy. Do you know that? Have you ever tried to do that? It doesn't work very well.
It's
have you noticed that?
It's a fear-based place. Yeah.
Once you try to hold on to it, it's fear that starts driving you. You're afraid of it losing the joy, and fear starts driving you, and then you start making some very bad decisions after that point, trying to hold on to that joy. You know, joy, let pass through you. The more you let these emotions pass through you, and the closer you get to God, the more the positive emotions will pass through you. And in the end, once you're at one with God, you'll have 100% of time really loving and joyful emotions passing through you. Does that make sense? But every time you start developing joy and you get to a point, oh, I'm really happy now. I'm really happy. I'm really happy with my partner. I don't know if she's my soulmate, but I'm really happy. I've got to hold on to her for dear life, right? Hold on. You try doing that. And within 6 months, you're going to have a very bad relationship. And that's because we haven't learnt to just allow ourselves to experience the emotion all the time. And as we grow towards God, our emotions of joy will increase in both the amount of times they occur and the duration, if we allow the experience. Mm-hmm.